Good morning, millennials. Welcome back to the Morning Toast. Happy Tuesday. I'm excited to be in studio with a first timer on the show and your first podcast in 2 years. Is that correct?
In two freaking years. I don't think you know. Wait, I don't think you understand what a big deal this is. Like,
same.
Because for eight years, I was doing podcasts 24/7, not just my own, but other people's. You know how podcast swaps go.
Of course.
And then all of a sudden, for 2 years,
silence.
Nothing. So, like, I do feel like I'm gonna puke a little bit.
No,
I'm like a tad nervous.
Of course. I mean, any like interview after like a scandal is like always a big deal, but people are really excited you're on the show. And today's a special day because it is the pub day for your book.
Yes.
And by the way, I just have to say the title is so good. Off With My Head, The Definitive Basic Bitch Handbook to Surviving Rock Bottom. It's out today.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Yes.
Thank you.
Now, I know you were always planning on writing a second book, right?
Yes.
After the success of Next Level Basic.
Yes. So actually, I was like 70% done that second book.
Yeah.
And shit went down in June of 2020. And I was like, we're going to have to regroup.
Right.
And begged my publishers pretty much and was like, please, you're the last
hope.
The last hope I have. Please don't get rid of me. And they said, they gave me the longest extension ever and said, you know what? Go rewrite it. And rework it, and this is now what it is. And it's so much better than what I had before.
Yeah.
Because what I had before was so chuggy when you think about it.
Right, and basic. But
it was just a follow-up to Next Level Basic.
Right.
And like there wasn't like the heart that this has.
And you actually have something to say now, something quite important.
Yes.
So let's go through it, okay?
And
you
also, wait, can I just say, I became such a huge fan of yours and Jackie's over
love to see
over
it.
Quarantine. I was like, I didn't listen to any podcasts for a really long time.
Because people were talking about you?
No, just because my podcast got canceled. So I was like, I just like can't. It hurts too much.
I feel that.
And then after a while I was like, okay, I'm ready to like get back in there. Mm-hmm. And yours was the first one I started
that
with.
Is so sweet.
And I am a huge fan.
Yes.
So I'm really excited to be
we
here.
Love to see toasters just popping up out of nowhere. It's the best. But let's talk through it. Okay, so you shot to stardom, Vanderpump Rules. I would say a lot of people would consider you their favorite cast member for a really long time.
For a really long time, yeah.
Yeah, and
back in the day.
So you're on the show for what, like seven seasons?
Eight seasons. I took some time off in the middle.
Who could forget Patrick in New York? Yes, thank you for reminding me.
Great time.
And you were really like a fan favorite on the show. And you had all these things going on. You had the podcast, you had the podcast tour, you had a New York Times bestselling book. So it really seemed like everything was going well. Then you met Bo and everyone was like, fuck yes, this is how it ends. Like it was all really, really going well.
How boring.
No, so
something
boring.
Had to happen.
100%.
Something had to happen.
And what I find interesting is like you really weren't a stranger to controversy, even at, you know, the height of all of your success. Mm-hmm. You had a lot of like backlash for things you had said. Everyone remembers Nazi chic. Personally, as a Jew, I wasn't offended by it, but I see that other people were, and I'm not going to diminish your trauma. But personally, I didn't think it was that big a deal. But you had these little things before.
Yeah, well, no, I had been canceled quite a few times before. And I talk about this in the intro.
I was just reading it.
Of the book, where, like, I had made a joke to my friend Katie. She'd asked me on her podcast, you know, do you think you would be canceled again? And like, do you think now you know how to handle it? And I'm like, I absolutely will know how to handle it if this ever happens to me. Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, I got this. I've been through being canceled so many times. You know.
No, nothing really can ever prepare a human being for what it's like to be universally hated.
Like, no.
And I imagine for me, like the weirdest thing about watching your whole scandal was like, you obviously were going through the scandal and then found out you were pregnant.
Well, I'd already found out. I was already.
We found out you were pregnant.
Yes.
I apologize.
Yeah.
And how far along were you when like the major scandal, like the core of it happened?
I was 9 weeks pregnant. Yeah.
And they say the worst thing for a pregnancy is stress.
Is stress. Yeah. The amount of people texting me being like, just try and stay calm.
Right.
Like really just like stay zen. Fucking stay zen.
No,
I'm
like
sobbing, dry heaving on the floor of my house. Like, what do you mean stay zen? This baby will get the strength that I have from all of my tears right now and all of my emotional breakdown. So like, I get, you know what? Please stop telling me to say stay zen.
Like, yeah, but how did you navigate that? Because like, you have to be very conscious of your stress levels. you're going through something stressful.
It's kind of impossible when you're going through something like this. It was a good week of hell and not being able to stay stress-free. But after that week, once everything was done, like once I was fired from everything.
Right, let's go. So Bravo fired you?
They were, the last ones to fire me.
Your podcast was canceled.
Well, it started with like my my sponsors.
Right, of course.
Which I expect, I expect, of course. I've been through that before.
Yes, yeah, sponsors all gone.
I'm like, that's fine, we're gonna be fine.
Right.
Then my publicist dropped me, which then had made my agency drop me. So I lost all of my management and all that.
Been there.
So then it was, then I think it was Bravo who fired me. Then my podcast fired me. And
the hits just keep on coming.
And they deleted all my episodes.
Right.
And then my tour venues just started.
Right. Been there.
Started canceling. And then one of the hardest things was that I'd sold the rights to Next Level Basic.
Oh my God, I was just reading about that in your book.
Yeah, and to be made into an animated series. And it was like, to me, that was like the highlight of my career thus far. And I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna be able to like quit reality TV. I'll be in like a writer's room, working on something, creating something, doing something different. At least like I'll have like, this is it. This is what I've been building towards. And that
also
fell through. So the only thing I was left with, was this book.
And your Instagram.
And my, which no one liked at that point.
Right, so no, of course.
I really couldn't use it.
Were you, how active on social media were you? Were you reading everything that was being written?
There were days that I did, and then days where I was like, I will actually throw myself off the roof
if
of
I continue.
My home if I keep doing this. So yeah. I can't. So that's when I like stopped looking at social media altogether except for Pinterest.
Right. That's such a happy place.
It is.
But you know when you've infiltrated Pinterest with your scandal, like you're in big trouble.
You know shit has gone down.
Well, was there a financial element for you because you had just bought a house?
Yes.
Yeah, right? And then it was like, could your timing have been worse?
Yes, of course. I just bought a house and was about to have a baby. I found out I was pregnant. And like, I'm losing all of my everything. Income. What the fuck am I going to do? Mm-hmm. What the fuck am I going to do? So yeah, that was...
tough.
Yeah.
So now what, we're like 2 years out. When you look back on that incident, a lot of people were upset. You called the police on Faith.
Well, there was a tip line that was called.
Okay.
So there was an article written and they had a tip line number.
For the woman in the picture in the article. And you thought it was Faith.
Yes.
And you really did, like in your soul, think
in
it was Faith.
In my soul, thought it was Faith. And Kristen and I had like thought that we like did our due diligence.
Crime
and
stoppers.
Just fucking stupid, stupid shit.
We
acted on gossip and that was the problem. I did not witness anything. Like I did not witness Faith doing anything. Mm-hmm. And that is truly, I think, been the biggest lesson is to, you can't go accusing people of things that you've never witnessed before.
Right.
But so Kristen had called a tip line and just left her own information, not Faith's information.
Yeah.
And they never called us back.
And when you look back on the whole situation now, like at a glance, first of all, is there a relationship with Faith? You've spoken to Faith?
No. So back after, like the week after I lost, all my
everything.
Jobs and stuff. I had a couple people reach out to her to ask for her number, and she didn't want to give it, which I'm like, okay, I have to respect that this person doesn't want to. I get it.
100%.
I wouldn't want to talk to me either.
100%.
So that's been where it's at.
And that hasn't changed.
No.
Interesting. And so now when you look at that whole situation, you're far from it now. It's 2 years out. You're a mom now. You're back podcasting on Patreon. You've evolved in a lot of ways. What is your main... How do you look at that situation now? Like, what is your takeaway from it?
I mean, there are a million takeaways. So if you could be a little more specific.
Yeah, I think like my question is how do you see it now? Do you see it like it was something like it was really hard to go through, but you're glad you went through it because you're a better person now? Like, how do
100 fucking percent.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Because I don't think I feel like I was on this path to just not having to think about real shit.
Mm-hmm.
And I could have easily continued on that path, just doing reality TV, living my best life, podcast storing, me.
Right.
I feel like Beyonce.
Right.
And it really, I had to really sit for 2 years and...
Stew.
And stew, not just stew, but like take a cold, hard, deep look at myself and what do I value? Mm-hmm. Like, what do I want my life to be? What have I done wrong and why mm-hmm. are those things wrong? And how am I going to not do those things again? And how do I inform myself enough so that like it, that something like that doesn't happen again.
Yeah.
Because I have a daughter.
Right. Right. That well, that changes everything.
That I have to, you know, she has to look up to me.
And I love that you dedicated, obviously, your book to your daughter. It says, Hartford, you saved me. Can you talk a little bit about writing a book that is so deeply personal and kind of like, and I've been there, my book is right here, and I've been through the same exact, well, similar situation, and writing a book, just trying to explain yourself when a lot of people have turned on you and you so desperately like want them to know, like, I'm actually not this person. I'm actually like a great person and I've made mistakes. And I met, it was so emotional for me and I wasn't pregnant. So I know you wrote the majority of the book in your daughter's nursery. Mm-hmm. What was that journey like?
Okay. So I will say this, if I wasn't pregnant, I probably would have spiraled right. in this situation. I think that I would have dark passengered the shit out of mm-hmm. my life. And Hartford being pregnant is what really kept me like having purpose. So like writing this book in her nursery.
Yeah.
While I'm pregnant, imagining like what this kid is going to be like, mm-hmm. what I want her to know, what I want her to like learn, like that was so soothing and calming.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, I wrote this book because everyone's been at rock bottom.
Yep.
To some degree.
Of course.
To some degree. Whether it's a breakup or like, you know, losing a job, anything. Mm-hmm. Okay. A death, whatever.
Yep.
Like everyone's been at rock bottom. And I missed being able to communicate with my followers mm-hmm. and listeners. And during that time, I wasn't able to do that. Because yeah. if I posted something on Instagram without acknowledging everything that happened, like that's bullshit.
It's out of touch.
It totally is. And so this was my way of finally mm-hmm. being able to connect with them again. And Hartford was just like really what made that so special and yeah. got me through that without having to like down bottles of wine and take a Xanax.
And by the way, I think a book is a perfect place to do that because like, you know, you could have come back in any sort of way, whether it's a podcast, a book. And I think a book is really the perfect place for that because you can be very intentional and really think about what you want to say. I'm the type of person who's always like, you know, speaking and then thinking. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes like sit down and really have your thoughts put into words, be really meaningful about what you're trying to say is really helpful.
No, Claudia, that was legit my train of thought because so many people, and this is one other thing I learned during that time, don't listen to anyone's advice. There
totally.
Were so many fucking people, my crisis PR uh-huh. person, just like everyone around me being like, you need to just like keep on going with your normal life. Like keep out there, like start your podcast again, do this. Like, and in my soul, in my gut, like my intuition, everything was telling me like, no, mm-hmm. like there is no interview I can do. There is no like
redemption.
There's nothing like I have to really like sit and like have my thoughts like they need you can't just say something in 10 minutes to describe
yeah.
this whole experience. Mm-hmm. Like I need to write this out and I need to chill
mm-hmm.
and I need to be low key and I don't want people to hear from me mm-hmm. for the most part until they can read it themselves in its entirety. And mm-hmm. that's why I say in this book, before the chapter, the canceling chapter, I say if, you know, the only thing I ask is if you read, is to read this whole chapter in its entirety before you make your judgment. Because it reads in chronological order.
Got it.
So people could easily just pick up the book and be like, she's not taking accountability. Well, like I'm going in chronological order.
Right.
So like, just can you wait till the later right. end of that chapter?
Yeah, I agree. I think it's only fair for a judgment to be made when someone's read the whole book.
Yeah.
And now that your book is out, you did return to podcasting in a different way.
Yeah.
And I was actually really curious about what weird ass deal you had before that could get like, did you not own Straight Up with Stassi? Because
I did. I do. I
so
do
the network
own it.
Dropped.
Oh, I remember how this, I remember. Thank you for jogging my memory.
Because I was so concerned because podcasting is so like you own your shit.
Yes. Okay. So this is how it happened. They were able to take it all down from Apple.
Yeah.
But then they gave me back my
archives.
Episodes. And I sat there with it being like, do I want to re-release them on the podcast app? Do I want to do that? Is that making a
progress?
Statement by me like putting them out there? I don't want people to misconstrue that as being like, I'm still here. Listen to me,
right,
bitches.
Right.
So I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to keep them, hold on to them. And that I have them.
Yeah.
And I think people who have subscribed, they can still actually listen to them. But
if you wanted to go back and do Straight Up with Stassi again, you could.
Oh, I want to.
You do?
Yes. No, I absolutely want to.
Because your
podcast, I miss it. Right. I miss it.
Because your podcast now is private. It's on Patreon, so it's behind a paywall, which there is like a level when you're re-entering the world.
You inspired me to do that. I'm telling you.
It's like, a great platform.
You, the way that you've handled what you've gone through was, I'm sorry that you've gone through it. But at least it helped give some of the rest of us info. Some info.
That's why I do what I do, honestly, to inspire others. But I think a lot of people, like the number one question I got for you was like, when is your return to podcasting and your return to reality TV? So you do plan to return to standard podcast format?
100%.
At some point.
Yes. I have been waiting. This is, like I said, I'm like, I've wanted to kind of just remain silent and chill until this book comes out.
Because it's important. Mm-hmm. And then what about reality TV? Ever?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know because, like, it's so funny because, like, I have literally family members calling me being like, so you're going back to Vanderpump Rules?
Right.
I keep seeing all these articles. I'm like, not that I'm aware of.
Right.
That's not – I loved reality TV while I was on it, and I always would have – I always said, like, I would have done this for the rest of my life. Mm-hmm. I didn't know any different than that life. And then I – and even in the book, I say that because I wrote – it when I was pregnant and in the first few months that Hartford was born. But now that I know my daughter, now that she's a toddler, she's not just like this blob. I bet you even when she was a newborn, I'd be like, yeah, I'd go back to reality TV.
Right.
But now that like she has a personality, like she is a human being. Mm-hmm. I don't know that I would go back to reality TV unless I was in charge of editing.
Right.
And what goes out about her. And I have respect for so many people who do put their families on reality TV. It's really hard.
It's really tough.
It's very fucking hard. It's not for me unless I am like a Kardashian that has. Right.
Unless you own the company.
Unless I have like a final say in who's editing my daughter. I just can't have some random editor I've never met just like going through footage and being like, here, where Hartford's crying and throwing a temper tantrum.
Right.
That's just not the vibe.
I think that's very reasonable. But you are, it's so weird because you're not on the show, but you're still very much a part of the group.
It's, yes. And it's weird when people like come up to me and they're like, I love Vanderpump Rules. I'm like, I'm not on it.
Yeah, but you're a core part of the history. And I think a part of the reason why it was so successful, like when you backhanded Kristen in that bar, like,
oh my God, iconic. No, it's the worst.
Iconic.
Violence is not the answer.
No, it's not. But like on TV, sometimes it is. So you're still very much a part of the group. The group is still very much making waves. And honestly, the show is at this weird place where like the show itself is kind of irrelevant, but the castmates are not. Like, and I want to get your take because so much has happened off camera. More has happened in the last couple months with the Vanderpump Rules crew than the entire last season. So just rattle off your thoughts.
Okay.
And not thoughts. I need your opinion exactly on what happened between the rares of rumor that Tom Schwartz and Raquel.
That did not happen. Okay. And I was listening to your podcast this morning with your husband. And I'm like, that did not happen.
Okay, but if it did, what would Katie's reaction be?
I honestly don't know.
Because it's so weird.
They're in such a good place, Schwartz and Katie. Like, what I've been saying when people are like, how is she?
Right.
I'm like, they are divorce couple goals.
Yeah.
Like, they are handling this so well. Mm-hmm. Like, if God forbid, no, I wouldn't handle it.
No.
If they divorced me,
burn it to the ground.
Yeah, that's, no. Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't be like that.
Okay, Lala and Randall. Like, did you know what is that? Just give me the whole spiel.
Well, no one knew anything. We found out on Dumois.
You
or
did.
Not on Dumois. On,
like a fan account?
A fan account or something. So everyone was finding out at the same time. And so obviously, no. Me and Bo cut Randall off.
You did?
Right when that
Team
happened.
Lala.
Because it wasn't just like a cheating thing. It's way darker.
Beyond.
And I can't really speak on it because, you know, Lala has Ocean and they're going through it. But... yeah, no.
Were you at Sheena's baby's birthday?
No, but in all fairness, okay, I drove an hour outside of town to get to it because Bo and I thought it was Saturday. So I had planned.
Oh my God, you're kidding.
I had planned all of my, like, my manicure, my spray tan, like, packing for this book tour on Sunday around summer's birthday party.
Oh my God, that is the most annoying thing.
I couldn't do anything. And then I was literally almost there when all of a sudden, like, my blood ran cold and I was like, why hasn't anybody texted me today and been like, what time are you going?
Oh my God, I've been there.
What time are you going? Because normally that's how the texts go. Right. And I just was like quietly just like looking on my phone for the invitation. And I'm like, Bo. And Hartford was screaming the whole entire car ride. And I'm like, Bo, it's tomorrow.
Oh my
and
God.
That was, Saturday was bleak.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I'm sure like Bo wanted to kill you. Oh my God, that is so funny. And there was a lot of like, people thought there was like tea there, but there's not. You just missed the party.
There truly is not tea there.
You just missed the party.
Yeah.
The last thing I want to talk to you about, but before you're officially out of my hot seat, is you being a COVID bride.
Yes.
Very difficult group to be in.
I've been through worse.
Well, that's 100% true. But you are married.
Yes.
Legally.
Legally married. It was really important for Bo before I had birth to get married. And so I wanted to respect that.
You stand a traditional
for
king.
Him. There you go. And so we got married. We actually had a twofer. So Katie threw my baby shower.
Oh,
and
my God.
The Taylors were in town. And so I'm like, well, if we're gonna get married, the Taylors have to be there. Mm-hmm. So why don't we just do it at my baby shower
that
in the backyard?
That is so cute, actually.
Or tacky. But
No. I mean, it depends on how you spin it for sure.
Baby shit everywhere.
You know, it's budget friendly. You had just lost your job. Like, you could only afford one party. It's fine.
There you go.
But you are getting married, like, relatively soon.
Yeah.
Like, the big thing in Rome.
Yes, because you went to...
I went to a wedding there.
Yes.
Beautiful venue. Really stunning.
Thank you.
It's going to be stunning.
I got locked into that venue because my wedding was supposed to be on Vanderpump Rules. And so when we went wedding scouting, we had a producer come with us. And wherever we chose had to sign off on...
waivers
on all of that, and once COVID rolled around, they did not let me out of it.
Ooh.
So Bo and I were like, okay, so do we just eat that money,
right,
or do we just try and reimagine what this wedding will be
off camera,
cut the guest list to like 3 people,
right?
And that's what we're doing pretty much.
And so when your wedding was going to be on Vanderpump Rules, I think I know the answer to this question, but does production pay for
not
$1.
Thing. Okay. This is what they pay for. An extra day. So the day they paid for the, like, instead of just getting the venue the day of the wedding, they pay for the day before so they can set up lighting and production and all of that. So like, nothing for me.
And how many people were going to be at your wedding when you were filming it?
A little over like 100, like 120.
And now?
Now it's like 35.
And Taylor Schreker is marrying you.
Yes.
Which is literally the most iconic thing ever. She's such a queen.
I'm so excited.
And honestly, even though I think like you really were stellar on the show, but you went through a weird period where you like moved to New York and you thought you were better than everyone.
I know.
And that was like not the best thing for you. But Taylor Schreker came out of that, right? You met her when you were here.
Yes. So when I think about like all of the, that was like the most miserable time. ever. I literally lived in like a 250 square apartment with my ex-boyfriend.
Who was so mean.
He was really mean to me and wouldn't talk to me for like days at a time.
Yeah.
So I would either call Taylor or I would go to the Mexican restaurant across the street.
Both good options.
And call my mom or my friends and be like, what am I doing? And I am such a prideful person that I was like, well, I can't move back now. Like I made this decision. I made this so public and look at me, I'm here, that I was like, I'm going to ride this so hard.
Yeah.
Mistake. But Taylor, who
was a blessing,
is my
closest friend,
sister, like my best friend, like that makes it all worth it.
See, really, everything happens for a reason.
Yeah.
That was just like so funny.
No, it wasn't.
No, like as a viewer, it was like, what is this bitch doing? Like, things couldn't be going better for you. Like, you're like the queen bee. Like, get back here.
I know. And then I dressed like everyone said that I dressed like
you were dressing weird.
I know. What do they say?
Like, it was like grunge.
Like the Secretary of State's wife, like a senator's wife or something. And I'm like, I look back, I'm like, that is so accurate.
Yeah, but it was just emblematic of that time in your life. I don't think that's bad.
Oh my God.
It was iconic too. It was fucking hilarious.
I was not thriving.
No, not thriving. But you're back out now. New book, everyone. Off with my head. And Stassi's going to join me for the Fast Five because you are a pop culture girly.
Oh, yes, I am.
What are you into? Well, we were talking about before how like you don't watch Bravo anymore, obviously.
No, I mean, I watched Vanderpump Rules to support my friends that are still on it. But I haven't. And also, once you have a baby, you don't have time.
That's what
Jackie
says.
Sit and like watch like all the TV in the world. Mm-hmm. So like I have to really love what I'm watching. And I feel like I can't just watch like mindless shit anymore. Mm-hmm. If it's not like inspiring me in some way, I hate myself.
I agree.
Like, I just, yeah.
And are you a Kardashian stan? It's like important before we move forward. I need to know
100%.
Okay, good.
I love the Kardashians.
Me too. Which Kardashian like do you think you relate to most?
Okay, so like it changes.
Of course.
It changes all the time. I used to think Khloe, and then I went through a phase where I was like, I'm so Kourtney. Like Kourtney is it. But like Kim is just like,
she's it.
She's my inspo right now.
100%. I used to be like a Khloe girly too.
And I still am a Khloe. Like
100%.
Khloe is the best. They're all, it's like, I hate choosing a favorite because I love them all.
It's like choosing a favorite child.
Yeah. I feel like I'd have an easier time doing that. Yeah. If I had multiple
Who do you think
children.
Your favorite child is? Actually, I think I might have an easier time choosing my favorite child.
I feel like you're right.
100%. Okay, so Stassi's going to join me for the Fast 5 stories that you need to know before you wake up and take a bite out of your morning toast. And today's episode is brought to you by Pear Eyewear. Change up your look in a snap. Pear Eyewear's base frame and magnetic top frame combination make it super easy to switch up your style. The base frames start at just $60, including prescription lenses. There are hundreds of top frame designs to choose from, and you can match whichever base frame that you want. There's also have the Pair for a Pair program, so every pair purchased, Pair will provide glasses and vision care for children around the world, which is just wonderful. You can get glasses as unique as you are. One pair, infinite style, starting at just $60. Go to PairEyewear.com. That's PairEyewear.com/toast for 15% off your first purchase. That's 15% off at PairEyewear.com/toast. Today's episode is also brought to you by Liquid IV. When you push your body too hard or you just feel run down, it's extremely important to stay hydrated. And Liquid IV's one stick hydration multiplier into 16 ounces of water will hydrate you 2 times faster and more efficiently than water alone. Liquid IV's hydration comes in refreshing flavors like watermelon, lemon lime, strawberry, pina colada, and more. One stick of Liquid IV and 16 ounces of water hydrates you faster and more efficiently than water alone. So if you struggle to drink water because it doesn't taste that good, I agree, and you should try Liquid IV. They have 5 essential vitamins, B3, B5, B6, B12, and vitamin C. They also have 3 times the electrolytes of traditional sports drinks, and it's made with premium ingredients that are non-GMO, free of gluten, dairy, and soy. So grab Liquid IV in bulk nationwide at Costco, or you can get 25% off when you go to liquidiv.com and use the code TOAST at checkout. That's 25% off anything you order when you use promo code TOAST at liquidiv.com. Experience better hydration today. liquidiv.com. That promo code is TOAST for 25% off anything you order. All right, Stassi,
wait,
are you ready?
Can I just say?
Please.
I drink Liquid IV all day. I have it with me. It's literally, I am a Liquid IV freak.
Girly.
It's everything.
And a hangover?
Well, I don't get hangovers because I drink so much Liquid IV.
100%. All right, let's dive in to the Fast 5. The first story is like not really breaking news, but I wanted to get your take on it because you have met Lisa Vanderpump several times. She's online beefing with Erika Jayne.
Right now.
Yeah, currently. Because Erika, did you see that Erika threw out Garcelle's book?
Yes.
Okay.
I did see that.
So then Lisa Vanderpump.
Which is like sad. Don't throw out a book.
Recycle it, girl. Give like it, the
like,
earth.
Just like give it to someone.
The earth.
Like it would have been way more interesting to just be like passing this along.
Yep.
Yeah, no.
And it just could have gone to a better home.
Yeah, agreed.
So Lisa was asked about it and Lisa responded, I thought that was pretty mean, honestly. Maybe Erika didn't understand it. Maybe Garcelle should have sent her a scratch and sniff book or something. So she was being shady. So Erika got shady back and basically said, Lisa Vanderpump's mouth reeks of garlic, cigarettes, and Chardonnay. So I thought that was kind of interesting because like I kind of do see that for Lisa Vanderpump.
No, well, she doesn't drink Chardonnay.
Oh, that's true. She's a rosé girly.
Yeah, so you already. Already.
She's off.
That's off.
But Lisa Vanderpump does smoke cigarettes.
Rarely. So she doesn't smell. No, she doesn't.
We
smell
saw
like
her
cigarettes.
In Dubai on Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, getting angry and having a cigarette with Ken, and it was like seeing, you know, like a teacher out of school.
100%.
It was just like
I know
crazy.
What you mean. Yeah, totally.
Have you seen Lisa Vanderpump smoke a cigarette?
In the past, yeah. Back when I was smoking cigarettes in 2012.
Well, that was another question. Cigarettes are like a main character on Vanderpump Rules, which is just so weird. Like, you know, why don't you guys just like vape?
Are they still a main character?
Well, with some of the guys, yes. Not so much since everyone has had kids.
Okay.
But like up until recently, like the cigarettes were literally like the plot.
No, I start like this is going to turn orange. The spray tan is going to start sweating into this vest. When I think back on like the first like 2 seasons of Vanderpump Rules, like it's literally just
chain smoking.
I'm like, what the I can't believe that was what
I know.
It is. Yeah, no, ugh, it's embarrassing.
It's so crazy. Like, it's just cigarettes.
It's so
such
vintage.
Right.
Maybe it's going to look like cool and like, you know, James Dean-y someday.
Like how we look back at like Lindsay Lohan's like heroin chic era.
Oh my
like,
gosh. Yeah.
That's going to be you guys. It's such a throwback. I agree. It's like so random. Like, get a Juul like everyone else.
In all fairness, there were no Juuls in 2012.
That's true. The show has been on for so long.
Yeah, it's been an eternity.
So what does Lisa Vanderpump's breath smell like? That's what I wanted to ask
well,
you.
I haven't got close enough to smell it. That there's that. Do you smell people's breath?
Okay, so I happen to have like a nose like a hound, and I'm very breath conscious. Like, I'm really like, ask Ben, I'm always like, your breath, because like, there's two different types of breath, let's be honest. Breath that smells like food, which really doesn't bother me unless you're eating something like really smelly. But if you're just like tasting like your tacos, like that doesn't bother me because, you know, it's food. But then it's like breath that's like, I can't really explain it. Like, it's like the smell of your insides.
But that's not, people can't help that. That's like called halitosis.
No, no. There is halitosis for sure. But then there's also just poor dental hygiene.
Okay.
And I think the latter is inexcusable.
No!
I at all times, I have like Listerine strips, gum, mint. I'm so breath conscious. And I just wish more people were like that.
I get it. But like, I have like, I have a soft spot in my heart for people that have that problem. Because I feel like it's like a digestive thing
in
your stomach.
And I'm not talking about those people. I agree. Like, there are medical issues. And that is totally not your fault. I'm not talking about that.
Okay, if you don't have halitosis and your breath smells like your insides,
that's
done.
Unfair. That's done. Unfair to us. And you know what? That's kind of like what I miss about wearing a mask. Like, I didn't have to smell anyone's breath but my own, which wasn't pleasant. I'm not going to lie. Smelling your own breath, no matter how good it is like...
Or you know what was the worst? Mm. Is like when you wore the same mask for so long
and then you had your stank on it.
That when you put it on, then you like, you're like, does my breath smell like this? Holy shit. I'm 100%. One of those people.
Well, you know what? Do you still have a relationship with Lisa Vanderpump?
We're friendly when we see each other, mm-hmm. but it's not anything really more than that.
Now, I don't know what I did to you, but I'll take a Pinot Grigio. I've been wanting to say that for like an hour.
I hate it. Like every, I remember the exact moment that I said it, and a producer came out after the scene and was like, that's why we needed you back. This was after New York.
Right.
And I'm like, for what? And they're like, the Pinot Grigio, that was hysterical. I'm like, no, it wasn't. I genuinely needed a Pinot Grigio, and she was my server.
Right.
And I had no idea. I can't see the humor in it. I'm like, I'm too in it that I can't see how it's funny.
It's so funny. And it was just like so mean. Like, I don't know what I did to you, but I'll take a Pinot Grigio. Like, it was just so funny because Sheena was just kind of standing there like useless. And she's like staring at you. So you're like, well, I don't know what you want, but I'll take a Pinot Grigio. It was
funny. I need to start embracing this. I need to receive it. I need to own it.
I agree.
Need to just like find the joy in it.
What's the one line people like quote to you the most? Is that it?
One.
Yeah.
That one. Or I am the devil and don't you forget it, which I'm very into.
Yeah,
I'm proud
I feel
of
that
one.
For you. You're such a like true crime girly, right?
I have always been a true crime girly until it became so popular that it was everywhere.
That it became chuggy.
That now, but I don't, I wonder if that's why, like, am I just trying to be a contrarian?
Right.
Or did I just like, did I
grow out of it?
Grow out of it. Like,
do you consider yourself chuggy?
Yeah, I think so.
I think you're chuggy, but like in a really chic way.
That's so nice.
Yeah,
because there's something glorious about being chuggy. Because you're living
your,
you don't care what people think. You just like the things that make you happy.
I totally agree.
It's like so easy. But like, if I could be chic while being chuggy, I'm here for it.
No, I mean, like you're wearing a vest. Like that is not chuggy at all.
It's from Zara.
It's like a tuxedo
That's
vest. Like, I do you want to see me wearing that? Like, I could never. So you are chuggy, but like with a spin, like with a real, with your own unique flair.
I love this.
Yeah.
Can we change my Instagram bio
to
this right
chugy
now?
With chugy
flare. With a flare. Chugy but chic.
Chic chugy. Like that is totally you. So you can confirm 100% her breath doesn't smell like cigarettes, Chardonnay.
I totally can confirm that.
I don't really believe you because I feel like I could.
She doesn't drink Chardonnay.
I just could see a world in which.
She only has cigarettes like on rare nights when she's like.
Being
like,
attacked in Dubai.
Like out. Like, you know what I mean? I didn't want to be like hammered.
Have you smoked a cigarette? With Lisa Vanderpump?
Back in the day, yes.
Iconic. Okay, well, in other groundbreaking news, Kim Kardashian has joined TikTok with her own solo account after, of course, we know she made her debut with Northwest, and then she made her own account a while ago but never posted, and yesterday she posted. And she posted, you know, of course, with Chris Appleton and Mario, like, doing glam, just having fun, being girly girls in the jet.
On the jet,
because she was on her way. She was wearing this blue sequin gown, which she wore to the Kennedy Center on her date with Pete Davidson. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I inferred that on the jet, they were either on their way or leaving the Kennedy Center because she was wearing that blue scoop neck dress, which
life.
Was a very, very mature dress. I'm not sure it was my favorite. It was giving like mother of the bride. But she's on TikTok. And I, as like, I'm the resident TikTok correspondent here.
I know that you are very into TikTok. So
I follow you on TikTok. Do you follow me back?
Probably.
I don't think so.
This is the thing about TikToks. Do like the people you follow.
It's I
like
agree.
Following doesn't matter. Like the people that I follow, I end up not seeing anymore.
The notifications are not filtered at all.
So I stop. I'm like, I shouldn't follow people anymore because then I'm never going to see their videos.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the TikTok journey that I'm on is old vintage castles in Scotland.
Oh, is that what you get?
Like travel back in time with me to what it would be like as a peasant in the 1600s.
Oh, I
in
get
Germany.
Like
that's my journey.
I get like, here's a little brown pill you put in your belly button and you'll literally lose 100 pounds. That's what I get. It's and like honestly, I'm getting dangerously close to purchasing.
In your belly button?
Yeah, and like,
how does it hold it in?
And like, but like you put, that you makes put, like, no a sense. You put the pill in.
That is a lie and a scam. That is not real. Don't do it.
You put this brown, it looks like a piece of dog kibble, in your belly button, and then you slap a Band-Aid over it.
No.
And overnight, you lose 100 pounds.
I need to see this TikTok after
we're
done.
I'll send it to you.
I need to see this TikTok.
I'll send it to you. And then there's all these doctors reacting, basically being like, do not do this. But I don't know. I'm not convinced. That's what I get. Do you post on TikTok a lot?
Not as much as I, you know, in my brain, I'm always like, I'm going to be a TikTok right. girly. I'm going to do this mm-hmm. and I'm going to post multiple times a day. Cause I guess that's what gets you like, you
Views,
know, up there yeah. on TikTok. But TikTok is so hard.
Full-time job.
Like creating TikToks are so hard. I have so much fucking respect
These
for everybody
kids are
who
like
does
fucking
it.
Movie editors.
I don't understand. But also at the same time, I wrestle with it because I'm like, the thing I love about TikTok is that I don't see celebrities and or well-known people. It's like, again, it's like, here's an Anglo-Saxon home.
Right.
And this
it's
is
random.
Where they would make their bread.
Yeah.
Like, do people want to see my TikToks? I'm not sure. So,
I
like,
think
maybe
they do.
It's not. Maybe, like, I just want to be a spectator.
A lurker is also great. I spend, like, you know, a couple weeks ago, you do the screen time thing, like, where you could see how much screen time you spend on.
That's against my will. Like, it tells me on my phone and I ignore
it's
it.
It's so yeah. annoying. So, a couple weeks ago, collectively in 1 week, I spent 24 hours on TikTok. So like a whole day. Yeah.
Oh my.
Yeah, I'm really mentally ill, honestly. Like it's an illness. It really is. I need to get off. And you know, what is your philosophy on having your children on social media? Because you've really seen the dark side of it.
Yeah.
Are you going to be like a helicopter mom?
Well, I mean, if you follow me on Instagram, you would see that
I do follow you.
I post my daughter a lot.
And no, but so, I mean when she grows up.
Yeah, so this is now that it's kind of like with the reality show thing. At first when she was born, like I had like 2 weeks where I was like, I'm never posting her, she's mine, mm-hmm. like, oh my gosh. And then I was like, oh my God, but this is
so
the most important thing that's ever happened to me, the thing that I love the most, how can I not share this? Fuck it, I'm gonna share it. I've embraced it. And then now that she's a toddler, now I'm like,
she's recognizable.
Yes. And people, just the other day, someone came up and asked for a picture with Hartford, not with me.
That's weird.
And I'm like, no, my baby's not taking photos with people. And now I'm like, do I back off posting her, or is it harmless? Because is this just 2022 where people do post everything?
Right.
Like, I really see both sides to it, mm-hmm. and I can't fucking decide how I feel.
You'll figure it out.
At some point.
But I think more people should think about the other side. Like, I think a lot of people, especially a lot of people that I follow, are like really out there with their kids, and that just like freaks me out.
But see, we're going in the direction that like
we're like everyone's
doing it.
I know. No,
so
you're
like
100%
will it be weird if she grows up and she isn't on it? Will then she be like, You know what I mean?
You know,
I
that she's like a freak, the class freak.
I don't know.
No, totally. I think about that all the time.
See, that's the thing. I'm like, I'm going to fuck her up in some way, right, regardless of what decision I make. Mm-hmm. And that is so much pressure.
Oh my God, 100%. I could never. All right, moving on. Happy for Kim Kardashian. Welcome to TikTok. Follow me back. Next up, we've got a little Selling Sunset news. And I just really wanted an excuse to talk about the worst show on television. But Jason.
Is this the worst show on television? So I've never seen it, but I thought it was so popular.
It's so popular, but like if you have if you have a brain cell, like it's so dumb. It's literally dumb. Like I just can't use a different word other than moronic. But people are like quaking because this season started out, you know, Chrishell was dating the boss.
Yes. I see all this on social media and Daily Mail. Yeah. Yeah.
But so now like, and I'm only like 2 or 3 episodes into the 5th season and it's really atrocious. Like it's really, really bad.
But did you like it in the beginning?
Yes, in the beginning. And then.
It isn't all reality shows are like that. They're golden in the beginning because it's so fresh. Much more real. And like everyone, no one knows what the fuck they're doing.
And nobody has anything to lose. And so no one has anything to lose.
No one has any brands. Mm-hmm. And then as like the years go by, everyone's too scared to just like be themselves. 100%. And that's when things get a little stale.
But so why people are quaking is like, so Chrishell and Jason dated for 6 months. And then he dropped on her that he didn't want kids. And so now he's getting like a lot of shit for wasting a woman's time. Like, I actually think like the meanest thing a man can do is waste like a woman's, you know, fertile good years.
Right.
So he's getting a lot of shit for like being 6 months into a relationship and then telling her she didn't want kids. He didn't want kids.
Okay. Did she ask him before those 6 months?
Such like a good question.
If she didn't ask, that's her own fault.
We're all responsible for ourselves.
Yeah.
Personal accountability is so important.
So, like, there needs to be context.
Agreed.
Before we go, like, hating this random dude.
But just watching them, like, it's so painful. And the reason why I really don't like the show is because, like, the villain is Christine.
Okay, so I did see that she tweeted, like the enjoy show is so all the fake storylines. And I'm like, oh no. I'm like, that is like the number one thing. When you're on a reality show, don't do, because yeah, you're literally just shooting yourself in the foot and you're going to cancel your own show.
It's
you're
so
literally, you're
going to
cancel your own fucking paycheck by tweeting that.
But having said that, like, am I on Team Christine? Absolutely. So watching the show is like infuriating because it's all the women against Christine. And like, Christine is not, I don't have a reason as to why I'm Team Christine. It's just like all these other girls are like losers getting together, like laughing. All they do is talk about Christine all the time. Like someone could have just given birth and they're like, oh my God, did you hear what Christine did? It's like Christine, Christine, Christine. It's so lame. So it's just like, you know, you guys are acting like loser energy. I'm going to be on Team Christine. I don't have a good reason. I just am, because she's like cooler than you. She is. So watching a show where like the one person you like is so universally hated, it's frustrating.
Okay, I get that. Wish I'd seen it. Wish I had.
No, honestly, like you said, like being a mom, you really cannot like spend time watching things that don't serve you. Selling Sunset serves nothing. There is no purpose. Like, do not waste your time. I'm being dead serious. I'm just being honest.
Okay. I also think on reality shows too, this is like a theme that happens where all the girls band together and dislike
one person.
And it's always interesting how that happens, because sometimes, and for the most part, it's based in something that's off camera that they can't talk about.
So true.
And so then all the women that are friends look like fucking assholes because they're sitting around hating on this person. But the truth is they can't talk about the actual thing that is the reason why they don't like Christine Quinn. So I wonder if it's the same sort of situation. Reality show's so fucked up.
Right. But also I think a lot of it is just like, when you meet someone, like, you're not always gonna vibe with them. And there are people who you meet who are like, there's just something weird about them. Like, you can't put into words, but like, they're just not your vibe. Like, there's something intangible about like what's off with them. And in a reality show, that just comes off as you disliking someone for no reason.
Correct.
And you're not gonna like everyone.
Exactly. Which makes things complicated, because everybody likes to pit everyone against each other, and you're either team this or team that.
Right.
You can like everyone and not have to pick a team just because somebody doesn't like. It's not a way to live when you really think about it.
Were you on The Amazing Race?
Fuck off.
You were, yeah, with black hair.
Yeah.
Tell me about that, because honestly, they asked me and Jackie to audition for it once, and I was like, I would literally
do it.
Rather die, like, running around.
But it is like a real life adventure. Yeah, you do.
You have to fly coach.
You also have to like sleep in tents.
And like just stand by at the airport. Like no.
Yeah.
I print my travel documents. I get to the airport early. I have a glass of wine. It's just not for me.
Yeah, no. I would never do it now.
No, right, of course.
Yeah, I don't have what it takes at all to do it now. I was 16 and they did a family edition and I blame my dad because 100%. I was a minor. So like I had 100%. No control over the situation.
And did you like come close to winning?
Not at all.
No,
like, we actually lost in New Orleans, like 5 minutes away from my house. Like, so there's that. It was
that's hilarious.
So depressing.
Oh my God. Also, that just, it sounds like there are a lot of reality shows I imagine like I could do, I couldn't do. I don't think I could ever do Amazing Race. I think I could do maybe like Big Brother because you just have to lay in bed
all day. Fuck that.
You just lay in bed all day?
That is actually, I would rather do Amazing Race 365 days of straight than the thought of having cameras on me.
24/7. Except in the bathroom.
Is like, that is next level. I can't. I did when we went to Summer House.
Oh, I wanted to ask you about that.
A couple times. I put it in our contract. I was like, cameras in our room go off at 10 p.m. Yeah. They go back on at 10 a.m. I'm not on the show. You don't need that from me. Like, my mental health will start to fully deteriorate and spiral. I cannot handle that sort of pressure. Like,
yeah.
I need my, like, alone time to recharge.
100% to scroll TikTok. Paige was just here, and she was saying, like, Craig also hates it. Like, he will never come on full time because it's so disarming to
it
just
truly is.
And then if like you're having sex, I'm seeing two people having sex, I'm like, this is like porn.
I would never. I can barely make out with my husband in front of like a friend.
It's so awkward.
I don't do that. I can't imagine. Just no, it wouldn't happen. We wouldn't have sex for months if that was the case.
Oh, I wanted to tell you something. A message for Bo.
If it's negative against the Rams.
No, it's not. It's not. Okay. Even though fuck the Rams. no, I'm totally kidding. Kelly Stafford follows me on Instagram. I take back everything I said. I know that he purchased me a hat and gave it to Taylor Strecker.
And Taylor sent it back.
I want to blow up Taylor's spot and let you know I never got the hat.
No, I know. Because Taylor sent it back. And
what does that mean?
I don't know. It was so weird. Like this.
She came and she was like, oh my God, I forgot it at my house.
What an asshole.
She just, you know what? I think she's trying to like keep me and Bob apart. Like for real. That's the vibe I'm getting. All right. I have two more stories for you that are brought to you by Modern Fertility. We're all supposed to go to the OBGYN once a year for our annual checkups, but checking in with our fertility isn't usually a thing we're ready for until we have kids. And knowledge is power, so you gotta know more, and that's why Modern Fertility was created. It's easy and affordable. It's a great way to test your fertility hormones at home with a simple finger prick. You'll mail it in with a prepaid label, and you'll get your personalized results within 10 days. Get insights into your hormone levels, your ovarian reserve, aka how many eggs you have compared to other women your age, and you can get a ton of other important fertility factors. The results will go deep into what every hormone means, and you can talk one-on-one with a fertility nurse to review your results and your options for next steps. Traditional testing at the doctor can cost over $1,000, but Modern Fertility gets you the same information at $159, which is a fraction of the price. And if you go to modernfertility.com/toast, you can get $20 off your test. If you want kids today or maybe one day in the future, clinically sound information about your body can help you make the decision that's right for you. Right now, Modern Fertility is offering our listeners $20 off the test when you go to modernfertility.com/toast. So that means your test will cost $139 instead of the hundreds of thousands it could cost at a doctor's office. So get that $20 off the fertility test when you go to modernfertility.com/toast. That's modernfertility.com/toast. Speaking of vaginas, Lea Michele was so close to Jonathan Groff in Spring Awakening that she showed him her whole vagina. So she is, you know, oversharing. Happy for her. So they're doing Spring Awakening. These two met. Jonathan Groff is from Glee. I know him. But he's also the voice of, now that you're a mom, he's the voice of, you know.
I'm not, which?
Ice, the guy with the ice and Let It Go. I mean, in Frozen.
Oh.
Sven. No, that's the horse. Who's Sven's owner?
Kristoff. Oh, he's Kristoff.
I think he also might be Sven too. Like, I think he's all of the voices.
The horse?
The donkey?
The donkey?
Yeah.
What is he?
Yeah. He's like an ice reindeer.
No. I watch Frozen.
Of course, you
twice
know.
Twice a day, so.
So they are best friends, and they met like years ago doing Broadway Spring Awakening, and now Spring Awakening is like coming to HBO Max, so like they're doing press and being annoying together. And she shared something like, I just feel like I could have.
I saw this on the plane yesterday because I was like, what is Claudia gonna ask me about the Fast Five? I need to be like all up on my shit, and I'm like, wow, it's a slow news weekend. There's literally nothing.
This week has been dreadful. Yeah, I can't lie. But so here's what she said: Jonathan and I became so close. We were intertwined.
Was that it?
No. They're, okay. They're really just being lengthy in this article. Where does she say? Okay. Sorry. I'm starting again. Jonathan Groff said, Leah and I were given this material where we had to fall in love. But the first thing I felt was they're going to know I'm gay. Fuck. I never had sex with a girl. I'm in the closet. So I'm just going to pretend that I know what I'm doing. I wanted the choreography to tell me what to do and give me the moves to allow me to express myself. And thank God for director Michael Mayer. And then Leah Michele said, at one point, I literally showed him my whole vagina. And Jonathan says, I can confirm that.
Any more details or is that?
No, that's pretty much it. Just like.
So
unique.
I need to know, was it just like pulling my pants down or was it like
stirrups?
Let's do this.
You know what? It's so crazy because I feel like most women like have never even looked at their vaginas. Like,
I don't like to do it.
No, but like Jonathan Groff, a gay man, has probably seen more of Leah Michele's vagina than most women have seen of their own vaginas.
This is true.
If she did like lay on a table and spread them.
But I don't see the point in that and what that helped with a sex scene.
I literally, that
sounds like just like shock.
That's so Leah Michele, right? You know, she's have you been watching The Girl from Plainville?
Yes. I'm two episodes behind. Me too. Like I have two left. Okay.
Don't you think the Glee thing is so weird?
I love it because I love this. I love this specific reference.
I know. And I could really see how like, you know, a very impressionable, you know, unbalanced young girl can watch that show and like want the attention of having your fiance die. Like it's so twisted, but I was living for the musical numbers.
Oh no, totally. I'm very into it. Yes.
Anymore. So good. But back to Leah Michele. She showed Jonathan Groff her vagina and now I just feel like she should show us all of her vagina so we can really kind of relate to it.
Are you a Leah Michele fan?
I feel very conflicted because like if you knew the amount of influence Glee like had and continues to have on my life, I'm such a Gleek. I've seen the show 1 million times and I really identify with Rachel Berry, like being vocally gifted. We have that in common. And also just like, you know, being really like annoying. I actually really relate to the character because like we're both really annoying and like we're not everyone's cup of tea. And I love the show and I love the songs and I love the singing. But Leah Michele, you know, in real life, I don't know if I would like her that much.
Have you met her?
Yes, she came on the podcast and I have to say she was absolutely lovely. Absolutely lovely. But it doesn't discount what other people, you know, their experience.
Yeah, I've always been curious. I just think she's so talented.
Beyond
talented. But then you read these things.
I know.
But also it's like, you know what? She's talented.
I know.
Let's like her for what her job is. She's not out here trying to be like Miss. Like,
do you know about the conspiracy theory that she can't read? Do you know about it? Yeah, it's like really big. And I actually asked her about it on the podcast and she was like really upset about it because she was like,
wait, like genuinely upset?
Somebody
definitely can't read.
Yeah, 100%.
No, like if you get upset over that accusation, you can't read. And now I am going to be thinking about this for the next 7 days of my life.
And what's so weird is like we met her in like this apartment building. Like we came to her, she didn't come to us. And she like
because she couldn't read street signs.
Because she had this room reserved for us and it was like this room in her building that was actually a library. And I just thought that was really interesting and kind of beshared.
Do you think she can read?
So this girl, this podcast, and I don't remember the name of the podcast and I apologize, but these two podcasters like put together this PowerPoint on like why they think she's illiterate. Like over the years they've seen all these things and they just think like her and Ryan Murphy are working together, that he reads her the scripts and she memorizes the lines and she doesn't read her own scripts. And like they have all this footage, videos, her at signings over the years of them really putting together all this proof that they think that she doesn't know how to read. And it was like kind of a joke but also dead fucking serious, and it blew up.
I'm so shook right now.
It blew up. I'll find it and send it to you. And it got back to Leah Michele, and Andy actually asked her on Watch What Happens Live, and she was like, not thinking it was funny at all. She was like, no, like, I've seen it, and like, it's like so stupid. Like, me and Ryan Murphy, she was like very defensive. Me and Ryan Murphy, like, working together, like, why would we ever, like,
oh,
la la.
No.
Yeah, it's like, girl, it's a joke. And you being so defensive, it's like, oh, you actually don't know how to read.
Oh, does that mean she's not funny in real life?
She was, I have to say she was wonderful on the podcast. And, you know, a lot of people, I will say, like, who you meet who got famous for one thing, they always hate the thing that made them famous, you know?
Yeah, sometimes, like, I resent the shit out of Vanderpump Rules.
Of course. And for me, like, when you're so deeply impacted by a show, like, Glee really, I was raised on Glee. I feel very deeply connected to it. She was incredibly kind about it. She wasn't being lame. She was giving me, like, all the gossip on Glee. Like, she was so happy to talk about it and, like, indulge me in my fandom. So that was very kind of her, because I think a lot of people wouldn't do that. Like, a lot of people just, like, hate the thing that launched them, you know?
Yeah, it's because people are scared that that's going to be the only thing they can ever do.
100%. Okay.
So, the moral of the story, Lea Michele came right.
Yeah, she showed her vagina. And just, like, I have nothing to say because I don't know, like, why she would do that.
Like, I don't. It sounds just like I need to promote something right now. So,
and
let
we're talking
me,
about it. Spring Awakening on HBO.
Why
Max.
Did I not think to do this over my book? I should have showed somebody my vagina.
Wait, I have something better. Let's make some press. What is the craziest thing? Like, the craziest, juiciest tidbit in the book?
Oh my God, I have no. The thing is, I don't know what other people find.
We find juicy, like, celebrity, like.
Okay, I can, okay. I think based on, like, what people are writing about right now, mm-hmm. I think the juiciest part, first of all, you didn't read it to prepare for this fucking interview?
Bitch, I literally walked in today and my book was sitting on the counter. It just arrived. Where's my early copy?
I sent you a box.
It just got here today. Look, it's right there.
Oh, shit.
So that's why I put it on this pedestal and I started reading it before you sat down. You know, right. I like to read. I would have read it before, but I didn't get like an early copy.
Okay. I will say this. Before we got fired mm-hmm. and all that went down, Vanderpump Rules was supposed to transition into a new show called that was going to be called
Vanderpump Valley,
Rules or whatever. And our wedding was going to be the start of that new show. So it was going to be.
Oh, because you guys live in Valley Village?
I mean, I don't.
You don't, but everyone else
but
does.
But a lot of the people do. And so they were going to slowly transition us and have, like, and keep Vanderpump Rules with a whole new cast of people who work at the restaurant.
Younger people, like, yes. Fresh to sir.
Yeah. And then so the rest of us would transition into this. The way that, like, Vanderpump Rules started, where it was, right. Like, Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, yep. And it transitioned into Vanderpump.
Valley
That's
Rules.
What we were going to do with my wedding.
That is juicy.
That, yeah. So that's not happening either.
Obviously.
At this point.
like half the cast got fired. Oh my God, that is like such a juicy piece. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah, so if you buy my book, you can
read all
shit
about
like
it.
This.
Yeah, no, I started reading it. It's very good. It's very honest. And I think it's a good combination of like you being extremely vulnerable, but also like giving the people what they want, like juicy tidbits behind the scenes. Do you go through what it's like hour to hour, minute to minute, like the day you got canceled?
I used to.
Yeah.
I used to all the time. But like I quickly realized that you cannot live like that in order to survive.
I mean, in the book about getting the chapter on getting canceled.
Yes.
You give people a play by play.
I get full blown play by play every single day. What happened? Like I compare it to like the biblical like creation of Earth, except it was like the universe.
Right.
But it was like the destruction of my universe.
Yeah.
So
that it was. All right. Fifth and final story. We got the Real Housewives of New Jersey trailer and it's supposed to be like the craziest
season yet.
I know. But like it actually has been an amazing season. And I know you don't watch Real Housewives of New Jersey, but I just wanted to bring it up and ask you about your interactions as a Bravo celebrity with Teresa Giudice, because she is just like positively dreadful, awful, the biggest hypocrite you've ever met in your life, like really such a nasty woman. And I've met her in person and she's actually quite lovely.
I've never met her.
Oh, you haven't?
No, I never have.
But what does the Bravo celebrity universe say about her?
The thing about the Bravo Liberty universe is that we all want to talk about ourselves.
Yeah, so,
so
true.
I've never met anyone that's like, let's talk about Teresa.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You know, it's like everyone is just like so pumped up on their own ego. And myself included, I'm not taking myself out of that. That it's like, this is what I'm doing. There's no time to ask questions about other people.
Speaking of ego, are you friends with Tom Sandoval still?
We were never close friends. Like, if I see him out someplace, can we sit and like have a conversation and it's like good to see you? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. That's what it's like. But we were never
friendly.
Friends.
But do you guys run into each other quite a lot just given like the group?
Not that much. Right. I don't really go
out. Yeah.
My life is not the same as it used to be. So the only reason that I ever do run into him is if it's like Tom Schwartz's birthday or Katie's birthday or something like that. But that's pretty much it.
Is Tom going to move out of the house or is Katie?
I think they're both going to.
Oh, they're going to sell the house.
I'm pretty sure that's the plan. I also don't know if she wants me to speak on it.
Yeah, that's fair. That's so fair. Like, do you find, like, this is what I always say to Taylor Strecker, because, like, every time she comes on here, she has, like, had the worst job ever of, like, somehow.
She does. I feel so bad for her.
Me too, because like, I know she gets a lot of shit for being my friend, and I know she gets a lot of shit for being your friend too. And she's always, like, the punching bag slash just representative.
I know.
For, like, her friend's drama.
I know.
And as a member of Vanderpump Rules, do you feel that way a little bit too? Like, anytime you do any sort of press, and I know you haven't done press in a while.
I haven't done any, so this is my first one. So I'm like, oh shit, after this, I'm like, I should probably think about whether people are going to ask me about Lisa's breath and Randall and Lala. And
but like, whenever any of them go on Watch Happens Live, Andy asks like their opinion on every single cast member.
So that was my least favorite part of doing reality TV. And when like conversations have arisen where people have been like, are you open to doing Vanderpump again? I'm like, I can't imagine going and doing an interview and being asked about Tom, James, Lala. Raquel, every person, and like that being just the only thing that I have to offer. Like I can't do it.
No, that honestly sounds like the worst part. Like I have my own problems. Like I can barely speak for myself, let alone everyone else around me.
100%.
So the book is out today. It is Off With My Head. You can get it everywhere, right? Amazon, ebook, Barnes and Noble, indie bookstores. Off With My Head, the definitive basic bitch handbook to surviving rock bottom. Stassi Schroeder, New York Times bestselling author. We love to see two New York Times bestselling authors just like sitting on couches.
Just chilling here.
Check out the new book. It's juicy. You guys are going to love it. I'm already on page 7 and I got it this morning. So that's pretty good. I will be finishing it. Enjoy, Stassi. Thank you so much for being here. Good luck with your book. Good luck with motherhood. Good luck with podcasting, with everything. Thank you for being a toaster. And thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Of course. For supplying me with so much content. So much podcast content every single day.
That's what we do. Guys, thank you so much for listening to the Morning Toast, the Millennium Morning Show, where we deliver the fast 5 stories that you need to know every Monday through Friday on YouTube. So if you're watching this on YouTube, please feel free to subscribe and give this video a thumbs up. We're also available as podcasts anywhere podcasts can be found. So Spotify, iTunes, Stitcher, Public Radio, iHeartRadio, CastBox, all the places where you listen to podcasts. Find us Morning Toast. Leave a 5-star review about how beautiful, stunning, and smart we are. Have an amazing day. We'll see you tomorrow with Jackie O in studio.
That is so impressive.